So I'm sharing my screen in what I like to call this giant kitchen table, right, that is online. So this is a program called Mural, and it is how we're going to record all of your great ideas tonight. We're going to capture some things through a couple of exercises that Garrett and I are going to help facilitate. So I hope on the screen right now you can see a map of the study area, which highlights that 5-minute and 10-minute walk that David and Jason mentioned in their presentation. We're going to have two really straightforward, easy exercises to work with you on tonight. And the way that we're going to call on you is you can use the raise hand feature in your Teams chat, and we'll call on you. Garrett's going to help me monitor that as well. Or we can unmute you, and you are welcome to share your ideas audibly for everybody to hear. That is totally fine as well. So the first of the two exercises is what we call a 6-word headline. And simply stated, this is about you concisely describing the future of the Adelphi area in your own words. So what are the key things that come to mind? You know, do you want your neighborhood to be walkable, safe? Do you want to have access to different amenities and things that you could describe within those 6 words? So I would love to kind of open the floor to anybody that wants to raise their hand and share their 6-word story first. And if not, we can start calling on folks. How about that, Garrett?
Works for me.
All right, great. Well, Miss Tina has raised her hand. So, Tina, I'm going to unmute you if that's okay. And I might have to have Garrett unmute you.
You hear me?
Yes, how are you?
Good. I have two questions or concerns. One is, in the development plan, are you taking into consideration the current ecosystems along the creeks and the springs? That's a real concern to me because we've already had some development on the Adelphi Road, not in that 5-minute ring, but maybe more towards the Bellcrest Road area.
Okay.
And I don't know if that's within the domain.
Well, I don't think it's probably within the orange boundary that you see on the map currently, but I think that's a great thing for the team that's going to be running the scenarios to really take into consideration. So I'm definitely going to add that as one of the notes. And would you sort of translate that into a 6-word headline, really based on the fact that, environmental, awareness and, as the development is happening is going to be so important to the people that live here today.
Save our trees and deer.
Love it. I'm going to put that in caps. Save our trees and deer. You get, yeah. All right. Capital letters. Very good. Thank you so much, Tina.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Who's next? Let's see. Don't see anybody.
Nobody else wants to raise their hand?
Can you hear me? This is Tina. I had one more point.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Thank you. The other is, currently on Adelphi Road, we experience heavy traffic. Has the planning committee done a traffic study recently? And are there any... Has the planning committee discussed possibly putting in better calming areas on Adelphi Road, such as speed bumps, to deter the rush hour traffic that thinks that Adelphi Road is a super highway?
So I can take this. I'm on the core team, and so we have environmental planners as well as transportation planners, and we have studied this area inside and out. And the finished product is not done yet, but I highly doubt that they'll put a traffic, speed bumps on a 4-lane road. That's usually more on the residential side streets, but there are alternatives that have been looked at. And they're just, you know, they'll be wrapping up the plan around this time. Around June, you should have a more definitive answer on a lot of these questions.
Just a point of correction. So University Boulevard is a 4-lane road, but Adelphi is a 2-lane road.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I mixed that up. I'm thinking of the intersection where Adelphi meets University Boulevard. It becomes very wide at that point, but they still wouldn't put speed bumps on that area.
All right. That I can understand. And then just from a safety perspective, and then I'll let somebody else talk. You know, we have a lot of students that live in University Park, College Heights Estates, University Hills, and they traverse across Adelphi Road all the time. So that would be my third input, if I could, is that we really take into consideration the amount of students that are going back and forth and how we adjust for, I guess, if the train is going over that street. I should assume that maybe that this is all being taken care of, but that is a concern.
So pedestrian foot traffic is a concern.
Yeah.
Student pedestrian foot traffic.
At the intersection.
Mm-hmm. Okay. At the intersection up here. So you're not suggesting, Tina, that there's a lot of sort of, we'll call it mid-block crossing that's happening on Adelphi today?
There are. If you go towards Queens Chapel Road, that we have a high school, we have churches, we also have at the other end the University Town Center, and there is a lot of crossing traffic. So I don't know how much of that's in your purview, and I've written a separate letter about that, but I really think we need to take into consideration, you know, putting more pedestrian crossing sections along the Adelphi Road and maybe a few on a University Boulevard, particularly as you go down towards the park.
That's a great point, Tina. Thank you for sharing that. Okay. Excellent.
I will.
You are fine.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Who wants to follow Tina with some thoughts about what the future of this neighborhood should look like in just a couple of words? Constance, would you be willing to share with the group some thoughts?
I'm sure. I don't mind. Hi, great. Amanda. Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you great.
Okay, great. So I am a University of Maryland at College Park alum. And so this neighborhood is particularly special. It holds a special place in my heart. And it was great to actually hear Tina's feedback was very helpful, as was the information that was given during the pre-workshop. And so with all that given, my six words are safe, calming, authentic, diverse, colorful, and artful. And I'm thinking specifically about some kind of integration that could, some kind of art installation that could reflect the neighborhood, and particularly with focus on highlighting local artisans in some way, perhaps even like a urban street murals. I don't know if there would be some common space for that in the planning or development, but it would be lovely to see something like that.
That is so great. That's all I
have. Fear the turtle. Oh, go Terps.
I love it. That is so good. And you know what you're doing, Constance. Well, you and Tina both. Y'all are taking care of both of our exercises at once because y'all are telling us things that you would like to see in the future. So I'm putting those over here on the map because that's the second exercise. We wanted to hear about things you'd like to see and things you value, which clearly being an alumni of the university is one of your great values. So you're knocking two birds out with one stone here for us. So thank you. All right. So those were great words. Safe, calming, authentic, diverse, colorful, artful. Love that. All right. Who would like, oh, Tina, you got your hand raised. Did you have something else to add? Or was that from before?
No, I think the speaker who followed me was very eloquent on that. But I do agree that, you know, Hinesville in general is an arts district. So anything that we can do to provide some continuity in that regard would be really awesome. And then maybe having an open place where we can have markets, like a, you know, for, you know, fresh vegetable markets that we can go to. Even maybe consider a community garden, you know, that students can, you know, plant gardens and share the bounty with the public.
Yeah, I love that.
Love the urban garden idea. That's awesome.
Oh, I'm about to have to put a heart on here somewhere. Hold on. Urban gardens, share the bounty. Love it. Okay, excellent. All right, who else do we have on the line? How about Gary? Are you willing to share with us? Let me know if you can't unmute. See. Can't hear you, Gary, if you are talking. All right, we'll move down the list. Gary, you feel free to say anything in the chat box if you are having trouble. How about Elena Perry? Would you like to share? All right. Let's see who else we have in the room. We've got Tom. Tom, would you like to share?
Sure, I'll jump in.
Great.
Yeah, this is an end of campus that is very, there's a lot there. There's a lot of the schools there, the architecture school, business school. There's a lot of activity, the conference center. It's very distinct from the Route 1 corridor. But there's a lack of housing for students and faculty in that area. Mm-hmm. And so given the proximity to the Purple Line station and the opportunities that exist here, I think my six words would be walkable, transit oriented, and university serving.
Love that, Tom. It is truly sort of a gateway, right, into the university. So that's a great way to think about it, that it's serving the university, but it's also walkable for the neighbors that are there today. So,
but it also doesn't want to be the western version of Route 1.
Okay. Excellent. I'm going to put that as a value. How's that?
There you go.
There we go. Awesome. Thank you for sharing, Tom. Looks like, what's going on in the chat? Garrett, anything? Let's see. Oh, Elena's part of staff. Okay, sorry for calling on you, Elena. All right. So, Stacy, yay, you raised your hand. Go right ahead.
I did. Okay, yeah, so in that you mentioned that it is a gateway, one thing that I don't see as I go there is a theme, though, a unified theme. And it would be nice, however, if you could get a theme, a unified message going into the community there, or as you go into the university in that area.
What are some of the things that come to mind, Stacy? Like if we had to say what that theme would be, you know, what is this area? You know, how would you describe it? Or is it yet to be what it is going to become? Like, you know, once the transit goes in, you know, we could sort of chart the course, right? About what does the Adelphi community want to be?
Exactly. I don't know that it exists yet.
Okay.
Yeah. And I like the ideas. I mean, there were some, Constance, she had some things that I thought were quite interesting, you know, when she was talking about the arts, and it could also be related to the part of the university or parts of the university that are approaching as you come into the university. It could relate to that. You know, that this is the gateway to that part or those parts of the university, you know, that you open the door and this is the part of the university that you are reaching. But yeah, as you go into it right now, I don't know that you really can see that, you can determine that so much.
Right. So goodness, if we had to put that into six words. So definitely you like the word gateway, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it would be nice if it would be thematic.
Thematic, unified.
Unified and holistic.
Holistic gateway. Could we say campus gateway?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Love that. All right. Now, is Gary also staff? Garrett, did I?
No, Gary's not staff.
Okay. All right. Great. Well, Gary, if you want to chime in, feel free. If not, that's okay too. So I think with that, we have let everybody have an opportunity to do the six-word exercise, and y'all have contributed greatly to the what do you value and what would you like to see exercise. So we can build on that in the last couple of minutes that we have. So, you know, we've heard things like art and gardens and pedestrian safety and crossings, which I think are all really vital probably to the future, no matter what this area becomes. Are there any others that come to mind, maybe things that are here today that you just love and you would hate to lose as things redevelop over time? Or there might be other things that you'd like to see as new development does enter the area. I've heard ecosystems that we definitely want to preserve and that you greatly value. Are these neighborhood streets, you know, really calm and walkable on their own with the surrounding single family?
Matt, I'm sorry, I didn't raise my hand. I apologize.
Hey, that's okay. Go right ahead.
No, I apologize. I pushed the wrong button. So this is Tina. So when you were asking it in the surrounding, are you saying the surrounding residential areas?
Yeah.
I think maybe some of my neighbors might not be happy about this, but I think it would be nice to have a walk path into those residential areas. But I'm very, very concerned about the creek and the ecosystem there and whatever we can do to preserve that.
Do you see, Tina, a lot of people from these neighborhoods walking and biking? I know you mentioned the student population that's clearly, you know, making those crossings, but you know, are the families, the professors that are living in these neighborhoods, are they also biking and walking a lot?
Most definitely. Most definitely. Very, you know, especially since COVID. I mean, everybody's getting out and walking in the neighborhood and, you know, chatting on the corner. And so it's fostered more of a connection, really, with our neighbors. And that's one of the positives of the pandemic.
I'm gonna keep that as a value because that is helping promote community for sure. And I'm gonna add, we've got walking paths connecting to existing neighborhoods is something we might want to see in the future. So I think that's a great add. All right.
Stacy's have her hand still raised, or you have another question? A comment?
I'm sorry, I didn't know I had it raised. I should put it down.
That's okay.
No problem.
I didn't know.
Okay. We're happy for you to contribute, Stacy. All right. Anything else come to mind? Are there are there missing housing options for folks in this area? You know, we've got single family detached. I see a few apartments. Is there, you know, any desire or need to have some other housing typology? Have you heard from your neighbors, maybe, or even for yourself? Okay. So housing is.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
It's Constance again, Amanda.
Oh, great.
I would be interested in my county exploring a tiny home community. I know it's for some, it's kind of out there, but I would be interested in at least, you know, the county exploring that.
Okay.
Could definitely lessen our carbon footprint, and there are a lot of pros to it, to inviting that kind of housing opportunity into the county. And as it exists right now, I don't know if we have anything like that within the state. I would have to research that, but I don't know that we have a tiny home community in the state. But I could, please correct me if I'm wrong, someone.
Well, Constance, does that speak to somewhat of the affordability of homes in this immediate area?
Yes, yeah. It does. Yeah, and okay. It's just about being more financially responsible. And then it also speaks to that particular demographic with the professors, and we've got the student population there. I think that it would give a different, a fresher approach to housing would be the taking a gander at the tiny home community. Mm-hmm. It's a growing community, and I would like to see my county in on the ground floor with it. It's been all the rage, like in the Midwest and West Coast, and so it would be, I think, fun just to at least explore it. So, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Would you say, or do you think this area would be amenable to smaller units, but maybe in a more dense sort of organization? So whether it's townhomes or, you know, condos or things like that, is that, you know, something that affordable housing could be sort of wrapped into, even in a smaller unit that might be attached?
Perhaps.
Okay.
Perhaps, but I think that there's a larger opportunity where, like, urban gardens and community timeshare with, you know, homeschoolers and things of that nature, where there's more community being fostered in the tiny home, homeowner mentality. It's just a different kind of approach to life in general with the within the tiny home community. So I don't know that it would be fully obtained with the traditional housing footprint, i.e. the condo, mm-hmm. i.e. the detached or the semi-detached townhome. It's just, I think that there would be a greater opportunity for fostering community. Yeah.
I'm going to add that as a value over here. I know we've mentioned promoting community through walking and biking, but fostering community through housing is such a great point.
Yeah, and it's another one of those benefits. I think it was Tina who said it a little while ago. It's one of those collateral side effects of the mm-hmm. pandemic. It's kind of, it's been less social distancing and more physical distancing, but socially, we've gotten stronger as a community. So,
yeah. That's a great point. Socially stronger. All right. Love it. All right.
Amanda, just to follow up on Constance's comments, affordability, you know, is an issue. I don't know if the county has ever really wrapped its head around the concept of the tiny home communities, but I do know that there has always been an issue with the affordability for graduate students. A lot of the of the student housing that's been built around the university, which is oriented more toward undergraduates. They actually have bigger budgets because their parents are paying for it in a lot of cases. And so I know that there are graduate student apartments in this Guilford Road area, but they're older. And so I know that there's interest in trying to get a more affordable graduate student housing closer to campus, so that, you know, which isn't at the level of rents that some of the undergraduate student housing is more on the Route 1 area. And it's kind of more appropriate for this area in that it's a quieter area and it's more oriented toward families. And the graduate students aren't like the undergraduate students in terms of seeking excitement like you see on the other side of campus.
Absolutely. That's the first time we've heard the word quiet. You know, we heard about the ecosystem being important, but, you know, that quality of being sort of a quiet, family-oriented part of the community, I think might be something we want to put over in the six-word headline so that it gets picked up. So, Tom, you want to help me out? So, you've already provided one, but, you know, we're talking about housing choice, affordability, quiet. Do we want to add some of those words over here, maybe?
Well, I think you want to, I don't know how to say it, but you want to, encourage more, maybe both, for sale as opposed to just rental, to encourage and more in the affordable range to provide more opportunities for faculty and staff to be closer to the campus, but also opportunities for a more affordable housing for the students that want to be on this side of campus, but not the undergraduate students. Something that would fit more with the quieter residential area. I didn't say that very well. It's not six words, but.
Hey, it's okay. It's getting out the right idea. So, all right. So let's see. Encourage for sale and rental housing.
Affordable,
Joe, you got an idea? Do it, Joe.
Affordable housing for quiet grad students.
Quiet.
I like that.
Grad students, I love it. Affordable housing for quiet grad students. Okay,
you get the prize tonight, Joe. That was
thank you. That was all. Okay. I'm signing all right, off
I'm
now.
Muting.
Now he's gonna float to another room. All right, I'm still gonna move this over because I don't want to lose this idea of for sale and rental housing. Because Tom, I think that was a great point there. So. But in our six-word stories, we'll do affordable housing for quiet grad students. Love it. All right. What else are we pointing out over here that we want to see or we value that maybe is not reflected currently in our six-word headlines? Because I say that because Joe, in the background of doing all this, he's going to grab all of the words from these six-word headlines in all the different breakout rooms. And there's going to be this, we call it a wordle, but it's basically this giant word cloud that sort of highlights the words that y'all have said in these different six word stories. So I want to make sure that we get all these great ideas. So we've got artful. We said save our trees and deer. I wonder if we need something about the creeks. Let's see. So some kind of environmental stewardship might be something, Tina. Do you have your hand raised, Tina?
What about?
Yes.
Oh. Okay, go.
Well, I wanted to say work, study, raise a family.
All right, work, study, raise a family. Oh, I love that. Okay.
Very and then the good. Last the reason the actual reason why I raised my hand is that is about ensuring adequate policing for the neighborhood.
Love that. Okay. Get that over here. Ensure adequate change that to pink. Very good. All right. So does the group think that we've captured all of these great ideas from the map in some kind of headline?
I'm wondering if we have captured, Amanda, the concern for the waterway, the creek. Yeah. Can we say something like glorious green space and waterways? I'm vying for Joe's position. I gave him the prize there and I want to get it back.
Take it back. Take it back.
Does
it.
That help, Tina? I'm trying to get something in there about the water.
Yeah, that's good. Good job.
Okay.
Glorious. I love the word glorious. Glorious green spaces. Joe, you better make that one big in the Wordle. Okay. Glorious.
All right, now, Joe, you owe us now.
Glorious green spaces and clean waterways, Tina? Protected waterways? Yes.
Protected clean. It's very important.
Yes.
Love it.
Okay. I like it. Yeah.
All right. We've got affordable housing. We've got walkable, transit-oriented, university serving. I love that one. We've got our art. The only thing I was questioning, do we have this idea of community in any of these? So if we think about the future of this area, it is a strong, unified community that is also diverse. I love this word, the identity, that it has an identity, because maybe it's missing that today, right? So what if we said strong community identity? What's the add-on to that? Socially stronger. I keep looking at that. Strong community identity. All right, Constance, you're going to have to come back in and help me. Community identity.
Yeah, I was thinking of integrating that word authentic back in there, but we already have that. I think strong community identity.
That's okay to have the word twice, too.
Yeah, it makes it bigger.
Okay.
In the world. So strong, authentic community identity.
Strong, authentic community identity. I mean, it's not our best, but I mean, I think it'll do in a pinch.
Yeah.
Amanda, did we capture, I know we have the word walkable though, but I am concerned though about the foot traffic being one of those former university students. I know about the, you know, the walking across.
Your hands.
Yes. I don't know if we want to put the word pedestrian in there somewhere, even if it's like pedestrian friendly or pedestrian safety, or so, if we could get a 6-word about that, pedestrian friendly.
Do we want to include our cycling friends in that same one? So pedestrian and cyclist.
I think you definitely want to include bicyclists. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
We're all riding bikes now, too.
Bicycle and pedestrian-friendly. Because you're going to have the transit, you're going to have, you know, great walking and biking facilities, and it's going to be the whole multimodal experience in this area. Bicycle and pedestrian friendly. I think we can leave it at that, right, Joe? That'll get
wrapped in.
So bicycle and pedestrian friendly, that's great. I'm glad we didn't miss that because they're probably about to shut us down in a couple of seconds. Let's see. Have we gotten this idea of the gardens and the green space? And so we've got glorious green spaces and protected waterways, but this idea of active food and accessible food, community local food would be a part of that whole experience of the community gardens and
yes, sharing. That's good too, Amanda, because someone did mention earlier about like perhaps doing like the market open, fresh air mm-hmm. open markets in the future. So, okay, Tom, Tina, how are we saying this, y'all? We need another six word.
Access to
creating a space for food and cultural exchanges.
I like that, culture exchange.
Look at you, I love it.
I don't know if that's six words though.
We're not so picky in this room. Yeah. We just like the ideas to flow. All right, I'm gonna just call it because this is the future of the neighborhood. So I'm just gonna say it's a space for food and cultural exchanges. God, that's good, Tina. What? Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I think that might have gotten all the other great ideas from over here. Guys, y'all help me out if I'm missing anything.
We talked a little bit about diversity. How did you capture that?
We definitely got the word diverse, but...
And we just pulled in cultural exchange.
I wonder if this one could be boosted by strong, authentic, diverse community identity. You think?
Yeah, you could do that.
Strong. We'll have a thing for quick. Thematic, unified, holistic campus gateway.
Creating a diverse community.
How about strong, diverse, and authentic community identity?
Love it. Diverse and authentic identity. Love it. All right. Y'all did awesome. Wow. Thank you for being such a great group.
Thank you for being an awesome facilitator, Amanda. Really, you did a great job. Seriously, thank you.
Oh, great. Well, I'm so glad. What's that?
Do you have an empty block? Are you supposed to fill that block?
I'm sorry, I missed the question, Tina.
No, it says under the yellow blocks. Are each of those blocks supposed to have something in it?
Oh, no, it's okay. Joe will skip them. Okay.
Yep.
We had those in there as placeholders just in case, you know. But y'all came up with a ton. I mean, just great stuff. I think meaningful things that'll add to ultimately what becomes, you know, recommendations for this plan. So they're kicking us out. So we'll see y'all back in the main room and bye, it'll happen Amanda. Automatically.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, Tina. Bye, Tom.
Bye. Nice chatting with everybody.